Well, I'm Naomi Scheman, Associate Dean of the Graduate School. And on behalf of the University of Minnesota, the Graduate School especially, it gives me great pleasure to welcome you all here tonight. It's wonderful to see so many people out to hear about one of the more serious and as well as lively and enlightening sides of the Olympics. The University of Minnesota is proud to sponsor events such as this one because these events are exemplars of the very best of the university's mission of teaching, research, and community outreach and public service. The Tucker Center for Research on Girls and Women in Sport is especially deeply committed to teaching, research, and service. It was established in 1994 as a result of a generous gift from Dorothy Tucker, who was a 1945 graduate of the university. And the Tucker Center is the first of its kind in the world, and its director is here tonight, Mary Jo Kane. Now, one of the most important components of the Tucker Center is its distinguished lecture series. This first-of-a-kind series is significant because it enables the Tucker Center to bring to the university nationally and internationally recognized scholars and educators who address important issues related to girls' and women's sports involvement. These issues have ranged from exercise, health, and nutrition to Title IX and gender equity concerns. Speakers have included Donna Lopiano from the Women's Sports Foundation, Mariah Burton Nelson, Anita L. DeFrance from the International Olympic Committee, and Anne Bancroft. Now, tonight's event is a very special one because it highlights a collaboration between the Tucker Center and the University of Minnesota's MacArthur Interdisciplinary Program on Global Change, Sustainability, and Justice. In the activities of the MacArthur Program, graduate students and faculty are united by interest in the developing world and its peoples, wrestling with issues common to those societies and to minority communities in North America. The program emphasizes study and research on four broad dimensions of world society: global governance and transnational norms, environmental sustainability and social justice, war and peace in historical context, and production, performance, and representation of identities. Now, as you are about to discover, the focus of this unique collaboration between the Tucker Center and the MacArthur Program is to examine the social, political, and cultural influences of sport using the 2000 Summer Olympic Games in Sydney as a backdrop to frame the discussion. More specifically, panelists will critique the good, the bad, and the dangerous ways in which mainstream mass media represent athletic females. Now, both the Tucker Center and the MacArthur Program are committed to reaching beyond the walls of the university to engage with the diverse communities in the Twin Cities and beyond, as well as to foster collaboration within the university. And part of why I'm so pleased and honored to be introducing tonight's program is because of the importance of collaboration across boundaries with widely different and diverse groups within the university, as well as reaching out to the surrounding programs, surrounding communities with programs that are of broad general interest. And we hope to see a very lively conversation and discussion here tonight involving not just the panelists, but those of you in the audience. And in order to introduce the panel and get tonight's program started, I would like to introduce Professor Raymond Duval, who is professor in the Political Science Department at the university and also associate director and currently the acting director of the MacArthur Program. Professor Duval has a forthcoming book in addition to the books and articles that he's already published. His forthcoming book is on the state and the constitution of authority in economic globalization. That is a set of issues that are currently very pressing and important. He's also a very distinguished teacher. He's won, I think, all of the teaching awards available to be won around here. Outstanding contributions to post-baccalaureate, graduate, and professional education, the CLA Distinguished Teacher Award, and the Morse Alumni Award for outstanding contributions to undergraduate education. Professor Duval.
Thank you, Dean Scheman. As an interdisciplinary graduate training program concerned with issues of global social change, sustainability, and justice, the MacArthur Program provides fellowship support to graduate students in more than 25 departments and degree programs in 5 colleges at the University of Minnesota. The now more than 200 MacArthur scholars and MacArthur alumni share an interest in the peoples, societies, classes, and racial and gender communities that are marginalized by institutions of power, especially, but not only, in the global South. They also share a commitment to connect research and practical action to support the struggles of such communities and societies. To foster the research interests of MacArthur scholars and to encourage their commitments to practical engagement, we attempt to link MacArthur training activities to programs and centers with complementary agendas throughout the university. The Tucker Center for Research on Girls and Women in Sport is an important collaborator in this respect. This semester, particularly, the MacArthur program has benefited from working closely with the Tucker Center. MacArthur scholars participate in a series of seminars and workshops which together constitute the curriculum of the PhD minor in Development Studies and Social Change. In the fall semester, we offer topical workshops that enable students to address important themes through cross-disciplinary discussions. These workshops are always co-taught by 2 faculty from different disciplinary backgrounds, representing our commitment to boundary breaking, the kind that Dean Scheman talked about. This fall, we are offering a workshop on the theme, The Cultural Politics of Sport and the Olympic Games, which is investigating issues of gender, race, class, and nation as they are produced and performed in relation to sport. This evening's important panel discussion is closely related to, and in some respects is an outgrowth of, that MacArthur workshop, which is being co-taught by Professor Mary Jo Kane, the director of the Tucker Center, and Professor Douglas Hartmann of the Department of Sociology. It's my pleasure then to introduce Professor Hartmann to you. Professor Hartmann joined Minnesota's faculty in sociology in 1997, immediately after completing his PhD at the University of California at San Diego. His revised dissertation is being published by the University of Chicago Press under the title Golden Ghettos, Race, Culture, and the Politics of the 1968 African-American Olympic Protest Movement. He's published a number of scholarly articles and book chapters on the cultural politics of race and sport. Professor Hartmann also has a collaborative book forthcoming on race, class, and gender as together defining an emerging analytical perspective. In addition, he has recently studied inner city midnight basketball programs as a way to connect his concerns with the cultural politics of race and sport to questions of public policy. Professor Hartmann is an excellent and dedicated teacher who's been recognized by the awarding of grants for his work on diversity in the curriculum and the classroom. He's a much valued recent addition to Minnesota's faculty and to the Minnesota MacArthur Program's associated faculty. I'm pleased to introduce him to you.
Thanks. I think that's more than I needed or deserved as the, just all I'm doing is moderating here. It's usually Mary Jo's job at these events. We're gonna talk tonight about gender, sexuality, and nationalism in sport. It's a challenge in certain ways for me because as Bud described, most of my work is really about race and sport. And in term, that's one of the reasons that we collaborated on this workshop and on this panel was to begin to bring race and gender together for both Mary Jo and I. I was worried about this as I was watching the Olympics and thinking about this panel, where race was going to fit in. I was really happy for Mary Jo and the panelists when the Australians picked all women to bring the torch into the stadium and to begin to light this, to light the flame for the Olympic Games in the recent ceremonies. But I was thinking, well, where's race in all this? And then I was happy to see that Kathy Freeman got the final leg and got to light the torch. If race, gender, and nationalism don't come together there, I don't know where they do. Now, I still don't know exactly how to put all this together. But I'm sure that by the end of the evening, I will have a lot more ideas on this, as will many of you. So we're looking forward to this. And the first panelist to lead us off is Mary Jo Kane herself, a professor and director of the Tucker Center on Research for Women and Girls in Sport in the College of Education and Human Development. Professor Kane was recently awarded the first distinguished professorship related to women in sport and physical activity, the Dorothy McNeil Tucker Chair for Women in Sport and Exercise Science. Professor Kane received her PhD from the University of Illinois in 1985 with an emphasis in sports sociology. She's an internationally recognized scholar who has published extensively on the media's treatment of athletic females. In her presentation tonight, she will present a series of slides from print journalism that will demonstrate the various ways in which sportswomen are portrayed for their femininity and heterosexuality rather than for their accomplishment as highly skilled athletes. Professor Kane, the floor is yours.
Thanks to Doug and everyone. We're on a very tight timeline, so I'm going to begin my remarks. Over the last two decades, sport media scholars have consistently demonstrated that athletic females are portrayed in ways that trivialize and undermine their accomplishments as highly skilled competitors. Numerous scholars have documented how sport media images produce an endless array of narratives that equate male athleticism with courage and physical strength, while simultaneously equating female athleticism with femininity, sex appeal, and a supposedly limited physical capacity. According to these same scholars, the end result of such coverage is to maintain women's status as second-class citizens in sport, where in spite of the tremendous gains that have been made in the wake of Title IX, sportswomen continue to have less access to resources and fewer opportunities than do male athletes. What I want to share with you this evening is how during a time period where women receive more, and in many cases better coverage than ever before, they continue to be portrayed as fundamentally different than their male counterparts. I say this because regardless of a woman's athletic status, we are systematically reminded through ideology, social structure, and practice that she is first and foremost female. So a key question for scholars during a period of unprecedented growth in women's athletics therefore becomes, how do the media acknowledge that more women participate than ever before, while at the same time portray them as pretty and heterosexy, rather than as simply or primarily as highly skilled athletes? Now, what I want to do, because of the short time that I have, is rather than focus on any particular study, I'm going to present a variety of images from print journalism that are exemplars of what numerous scholars, including myself, have discovered in our research. And I want to place these first series of slides in historical context, because what we have found again and again is that female athletes are significantly more likely than male athletes to be portrayed off the court, out of uniform, and in highly sexualized poses. These first series of slides actually does come from a dissertation from a former student of mine who's now a colleague, Joanne Bicey, who's a professor at the University of Minnesota. And what she did was a nationwide study in which she looked at every Division I program in the country, and she compared the media guide covers of men's sports versus women's sports. So she looked in the same year at the same school in the same sport and said, how do these programs talk about women's teams versus men's teams? And if you don't know anything about media guide covers, it's important for me to tell you this. Media guide covers are literally, or media guides, are the things that athletic programs put into the hands of the media. They're also used as recruiting tools to say to individuals who we want to come to this university and to the parents, this is what our program is all about. The point is, these are very consciously constructed images of what women's sports and men's sports are all about. So this is from the late 1980s and the sport of gymnastics at Auburn University. If I could have the lights down. Next, from the University of Nebraska in the sport of softball. And I would suggest to you, if you take away the word softball, there's absolutely nothing in this sorority shot to indicate to you that the reason that these women are together is because they are highly skilled Division I athletes. I think the nicest way to make this point is to compare the University of Mississippi and men's and women's basketball. First, the University of Mississippi men's program. It's kind of an interesting idea, athletes playing sports. And then women's basketball in the same year. Whoops, that's Nebraska. Now, you may be saying to yourself, oh, I know, but that's the late 80s, come on. We've improved. Well, Professor Bicey just did a recent update in the late 90s, and again, she found that women were significantly more likely than men to be portrayed off the court, out of uniform, and in highly stylized poses. So here is an update from the University of Georgia and the sport of gymnastics. And then here's the update on Nebraska. Now, what I want to do very quickly is take you through three, given this historical context of off the court, out of uniform, and in these poses, I want to take you through three categories or patterns of representations that have been discovered in the research that undermine women's accomplishments as athletes. The first is what is called ambivalence or an ambivalent portrayal. And this was a term that was coined by Duncan and Hasbrook in the late 1980s. And here was their argument. Yes, there are lots of these kinds of images, but there's also lots of images where you have a kind of a dual message going on, where there's something to indicate that the woman is an athlete, but there's also this other sort of mixed message that tells you that first and foremost, she is female. So I want to just share a few images that are classic examples of ambivalent portrayals. First, from the mid-90s, this is from Fairway Magazine, which is the official publication of the LPGA, as in the Ladies Professional Golf Association. And there was a whole series of, pictures in this particular issue in which what the LPGA was saying to its reader is, follow us on the tour, because we're great gals and we hang out in really fun cities. And the person that I'm going to show you next is Donna Andrews, and the reason that she's highlighted is because in that year she won one of the majors. So this is an example of an ambivalent portrayal. And I think it's pretty clear what the primary image or what the LPGA is selling there. Next is from 1996. This is the cover of People magazine in which they're doing a whole feature on women's figure skating. Here's another ambivalent portrayal. You get a lot of images of women athletes, what I like to call gals on the tour having fun. Lots of images like this, and again, what I want to remind you of is that these women are highly skilled athletes who make their living because of their athletic ability. The final example of ambivalence is from the St. Paul Pioneer Press in their Sunday magazine in 1998. And for those of you who don't know, 1998 in the Winter Olympic Games in Nagano was the first year in which hockey for women was a medal sport. The U.S. women went in as sort of the co-favorites with the Canadians, and this is how the St. Paul Pioneer Press did sort of a preview of the U.S. women's team. Again, we get this goalie who's pretty and sexy. The next category that I want to share with you is what I call the ubiquitous but invisible L word in media coverage. And for those of you who know even a little bit about women's sports, you know that the L word does not stand for liberal when we're talking about women's sports. So, homophobia, along with sexism, have been the cornerstones of fear and intolerance that have kept women out of sport or confined them to second-class citizenship once within it. As my colleague Pat Griffin has pointed out, the insistence that sportswomen conform to traditional notions of femininity is really an insistence that they be, or at least appear to be, heterosexual. So to counteract such fears, female athletes have gone to great lengths to reassure parents, coaches, athletic administrators, reporters, corporate sponsors, and even themselves, that sports can and should be consistent with traditional notions of heterosexuality. I would argue that there is no more effective means by which such reassurance takes place than through media representations. So the next three or four images that I want to share with you are
and they're different from an ambivalent portrayal, because this is where specific women athletes are linked to so-called heterosexual roles of wife and mother. The most classic example I've seen of this was from the late 1980s when Chris Everett announced her retirement from professional tennis. And this was considered such important news that Sports Illustrated decided to put her on the cover, even though that typically, unless you have no clothes on, you don't get on the cover of Sports Illustrated. But they thought it was significant enough to announce her retirement. And of all the ways they could have constructed her two-decade career, in which she won 158 singles titles and 18 majors, this is how they framed her retirement. Inside, they gave us a pictorial chronology of her career, quote unquote, in tennis. We see her from left to right with her first boyfriend, Jimmy Connors, then with Burt Reynolds, in the White House with Gerald Ford's son, and then her first husband, and now her current husband. Another example of what I call the ubiquitous but invisible L word comes from the 1996 Summer Olympic Games, and this was in the Atlanta Constitution Journal, and the purpose of this article was to highlight women track athletes who were U.S. track athletes who were favored to win and did win the gold, and this is how they were featured. And then finally, the Sports Illustrated, after the 96 Olympics, Sports Illustrated started to sort of get it and realized that there was a market out there for women in sport. And so they announced that they were going to launch Sports Illustrated for Women. And so for those of us who do this kind of research, we were kind of emailing back and forth, who's going to be on the inaugural cover? Babe Diedrichsen Zaharias, Billie Jean King, Martina Navratilova. What do you think? Pregnant Cheryl Swoops. Talking about how she and the WNBA are due in June. And now, finally, I want to go to the last example or pattern of representation. And this is what I call the shift from feminization to sexualization of the female athlete. Over the last few years, and not coincidentally with women's increasing power in sport, there has been a significant shift away from a classy lady image to one that bears a striking resemblance to soft pornography. Indeed, images of nude and semi-nude elite female athletes contributed to much of the public debate surrounding the just-completed Summer Olympics in Sydney, and much of this debate centered around an image in Sports Illustrated of Jenny Thompson, who, going into the Olympics, had won 5 gold medals and then won more gold medals. And this is how this elite Olympic-dedicated athlete was portrayed. Now, this will seem tame given other recent representations of professional and Olympic female athletes. We've heard a lot about Anna Kournikova. She was also pictured in Sports Illustrated. But what you might not have seen is a 1998 photograph of her in Rolling Stone magazine. This is Anna Kournikova when she was 16. Next is Amy Acuff, a world-class high jumper who was also on the U.S. Women's Olympic teams this is a 1999 photograph from Rolling Stone. And next is from a 1996 series of photographs about diamond baseball equipment and catcher's equipment in particular, and of all the ways in which diamonds could have chosen to portray catching in baseball and softball. This is what they chose to do. And I did not cut her face off. That is part of the way in which a soft pornography works in terms of body truncation. Let me just share with you the language here. Take her out to the ball game with these diamond 28W leg guards and she'll return bruiseless. Now, many of you have seen the image of Brandi Chastain and her famous or infamous, depending upon your point of view, when she took her shirt off in the sports bra. But what you might not have seen is that Brandi Chastain did a series of poses for Gear magazine, and when a student of mine pointed this out to me, I asked her to go get the magazine. I thought that Gear magazine was about mountain climbing or bicycling. It's a men's magazine. So think back to how we all felt about the Women's World Cup soccer team last summer. And here is an image of Brandi Chastain after that event. And next and finally, at least in this portion of the show, is from Maxim magazine in September of 2000. This is an image of Nina Lynch, who is a world-class middle-distance runner. She's won four national titles at Villanova, and in 1993 she was a Rhodes Scholar. This is Nina Lynch in September of 2000. So one important question that I would ask us to keep in mind as we go through this panel, and one that Pat Griffin is going to take up momentarily, is why are female athletes consistently portrayed in this manner? I would suggest it is in part because being a highly skilled athletic female poses a direct threat to traditional expectations regarding sport, gender, and relationships of power. Or as Catherine McKinnon, among others, has pointed out, when women are involved in sports, it is about our bodies being active versus being acted upon. Thank you very much.
I think if there's people in the back, there's some seats down here in front. If you'd like to make your way down, looks like it might be getting crowded back there. So there's some right down here in the front. Thanks. It's my pleasure now to introduce our next panelist, Pat Griffin. After a 9-year career as a high school and college physical education teacher and coach, Dr. Griffin received her ED in education at the University of Massachusetts in 1980. She taught in the physical education teacher program at the university there from 1980 to 1991. She is now professor in the social justice education program in that school. Her research and writing interests focus on heterosexism, homophobia in education, lesbian and gay teachers and students, and heterosexism, homophobia in athletics, with a particular interest in women's sports. She is the author of a book that some of you who are in the MacArthur program are reading selections from right now, Strong Women, Deep Closets, Lesbians and Homophobia in Sports. Professor Griffin.
Mary Jo has provided us with an excellent historical overview and description of how some of the women athletes have been portrayed in the media and media guides, and described three trends of how these women's images are represented. I'm going to try to answer three questions. One is, what's the function of these images? Two is, why are we seeing these particular images now? And third is, who benefits from this particular portrayal of women athletes? Traditionally, sport has been one of many cultural institutions that reinforce a particular gender order that's based on a binary, static sense of gender expression for both men and women that reinforces male privilege and female subordination and heterosexuality. And as such, sport has been the primary arena for young boys and men to learn and internalize a particular kind of masculine expression that's based on establishing hierarchies of power based on size, strength, toughness, competitive accomplishment, and heterosexual prowess. Boys and men who cannot measure up in this masculine sweepstakes are ridiculed as sissies, faggots, and women. In other words, they're not real men. Women athletes in this context are trespassers whose sport participation must be trivialized, stigmatized, marginalized in order to preserve the male-only claimed sports. Women athletes have historically been characterized as not normal women. In the United States, we have a long history of questioning the gender expression, and sexuality of women athletes. This has been a successful way to discourage many women from participation in sport. Accusations of gender variance and lesbianism have kept women in sports on the defensive, apologetic, on the margins, and fearful about being defined as outside the boundaries of acceptable gender and sexuality. The lesbian label in particular has been an effective social control mechanism to warn women who transgress the boundaries of sport. From this perspective, sport is not just fun and games. Sport is about the maintenance of a particular gender order, socializing men into a particular construction of masculinity, and women who participate must demonstrate their compliance with traditional definitions of femininity and heterosexuality that counterbalance and soften their athleticism. At the same time, sports could also offer women a way to resist subordination, a way to challenge and broaden traditional definitions of gender and sexuality. Sport has the potential to redefine relationships among women and the ways that women see themselves as agents of their own physical, social, and psychological empowerment. And I think it's this tension between sport's historical role in maintaining the status quo and sport's potential for liberation and social change that provokes the controversy that we're discussing here over how women athletes' bodies are publicly displayed in the media. So how do we make sense of this recent rash of semi-nude, nude, and heterosexually provocative photographic representations of women athletes that Mary Jo has just shown us? I think these images function to normalize women athletes as physically and sexually appealing to men. I use the term heterosexy to remind us that this normalizing function is not about establishing some broad sense of sex appeal, but it's specifically directed to men. These images remind us that embracing strong athletic women is dependent on their ability to also establish their heterosex appeal. Sometimes, as in the case of Anna Kournikova, it almost seems that her heterosexual appeal is more important to her marketability and her popularity to men than her athletic accomplishments are. For those of you who are familiar with tennis, know that Anna Kournikova, though she has never won a major tournament, still commands a huge portion of the marketing and public attention in tennis. Over the last 4 or 5 years, we've had a tremendous change in terms of success and the popularity of women in sport, as evidenced by the World Cup soccer team, the development of the WNBA, the successes of the last 2 or 3 Olympic teams from 96 and 98, the Winter Olympics, and just recently last month. And also over the past 5 years, I think we've seen a certain degree of female muscularity and physical prowess being normalized. This broadening of conceptions of acceptable femininity has been accompanied by an increasing attempt to contain, tame, and heterosexualize powerful women's bodies and their athletic accomplishments. And that's what I think we see in the slides that Mary Jo showed us. Where it was once enough to feminize a woman athlete to demonstrate her normality, read heterosexuality, it's now necessary to present her as a sex object, explicitly appealing to men. These attempts to normalize women athletes, to heterosexualize them, is a way to render them less threatening to men and to the gender order that they have the potential to contradict. Insisting on the heterosex appeal of women athletes as a prerequisite to her public acceptance is the same old narrow straitjacket of packaged femininity, fantasized sexual availability, and objectification with which women athletes from Babe Diedrichsen to Martina Navratilova to Amelie Mauresmo have had to contend. We have always pushed the pretty ones forward, the Chris Everts, the Jan Stevensons, the Anna Kournikovas, the Jenny Thompsons. And now it's just more aggressive. But the blatant and pervasive attempt to present women athletes as sexually appealing to men is a very traditional and time-honored way to normalize women who are flirting with the boundaries of traditional gender expression and who challenge the established gender order. In this latest round of images, it seems that women are actively and aggressively participating in their own presentation as sex objects. And I wonder if some of the women athletes who are posing as centerfolds or in nude calendars are reassuring themselves as well as the public that even though I'm strong and I'm muscular and I could probably kick your butt in my sport, I'm still a normal woman. I am as straight and as mainstream as they come, and I want men to see me as sexy. Instead of I am woman, hear me roar, we hear I am heterosexy, see me strip. I also think that in the 70s and 80s, some of our favorite athletes were tiny, cute, pixie-like figure skaters and gymnastics. Most older athletes quit at the end of a short competitive period because they couldn't get the support they needed or there weren't the opportunities. With the advent of Title IX, I think a lot of that changed. What we have now, instead of tiny, sprite-like athletes who it's easy to infantilize, now we have adult women who, and it's more threatening to the gender order. And so that one way to neutralize their images is to sexualize them as sex kittens. Another aspect of this media representation is that there's a division in terms of how women in sport view these images. There are some women, some of the women who are posing themselves, and others who approve of or participate in these representations. And then there are other women who criticize them. Some of the women and the men who applaud these new heterosexy images that we see for women athletes talk about them in various ways. Some have talked about them as reassurances to young girls that women athletes are real women. Others have talked about posing as a way to reclaim their bodies or to demonstrate the pride that they have in their strong bodies. I think that's what Brandi Chastain said about her posing. Some of them talk about that these pictures are a way to demonstrate that it's okay to be a woman and be a sexy woman. It's okay to be an athlete and to be a sexy woman. Celebrating femininity and heterosex appeal is a good thing for athletics. Some women have talked about the fact that women athletes can now be perceived as heterosexy is evidence that women's athletics has arrived, that women can be sexualized by and for men and can capitalize on their heterosexual appeal. These women athletes present their heterosexuality and femininity as radical. They present themselves as cool, sexy, hip, liberated. And in fact, in one magazine, there was a headline that said that women athletes today are not afraid to be feminine, which of course turns on its head the truth that many women, for the history of women's sports, have always felt uncomfortable presenting themselves as anything but feminine. I see a new militant heterosexuality in these women's defenses of these images. It's almost as if they are relieved to be able to reject the historic stereotype of the athletic women as a lesbian by presenting them as soft porn temptresses. On the other hand, the critics of this hyper-heterosexualization of women athletes would contend that these images are simply objectification on another level. And in some of the sports press, sports writers and some women athletes who are enjoying these images talk about the critics of these images and dismiss them as outdated feminists, old fuddy-duddies with their girdles in a wad, that was Rick Riley in Sports Illustrated, man-haters, and of course, butch lesbians. So again, we have women who object to the objectification of women being portrayed as a bunch of old dykes, spoil sports. All of this emphasis on the heterosexual appeal and the heterosexuality of women athletes accentuates the persistent invisibility of lesbians in sport. The more we celebrate heterosexual women in sport, the more the absence of any lesbian image is normalized, and the silence is deafening. Lesbians represent a sexual expression that is untamed by men, whose presence must be hidden to assure that women's sports is acceptable, non-threatening, marketable to the public. The lesbian label has been used so long against women in sport that we're used to selling out the lesbians in return for a marginalized status in the world of men's sport. We expect lesbians to be silent and invisible. And this hypocrisy is carried out in organizations like the WNBA, who is happy to accept the money of lesbian fans and the play of lesbian athletes, but slams the closet door on them with the other hand. So who benefits from the heterosexualization of women athletes? I suppose you could say that some of the individual women who benefit from this image, the women who do some of the posing in the sense that they are media images that are shown around the country, they receive notoriety. They certainly receive money from advertisers and corporate sponsors who are interested in associating products with these women. And anyone who is a supporter of the traditional gender order in terms of supporting traditional images of femininity and masculinity probably benefits. But the losers are any women in sport who do not conform to traditional expectations of gender and sexuality. Women's sports is a loser because women's sports is co-opted as a vehicle for the maintenance of the status quo. And in a sense, we're all losers when rather than as a vehicle for social change and empowerment, women's and all of the glory of diversity of gender and sexuality that's represented in sport, women's sports becomes a striptease in which women athletes are encouraged to take it all off in exchange for male acceptance in a small corner of the male sports world. What would it mean if we saw more images of strong women doing their sport? What would it mean to women athletes, and what would it mean to the gender and sexuality order? What would it mean if we saw more powerful images of women's sport like this, rather than the images that Mary Jo is sharing with us? Women in their sports, muscular women, women in all of their glory in terms of their athletic talents. What would it mean if we saw images like this and more images where we saw self-affirming, publicly out lesbians, or lesbians with their families and their partners? What if we saw more images of women athletes who are older, women athletes who were big, women athletes whose physical power cannot be packaged or disguised so easily. What if we saw more women athletes who were gender variant in appearance or identity? What if we saw women who claim and present their sexualities in ways that are not directed solely at men? What if we saw women who were muscular in ways that exceed social tolerance for muscular women? If we saw these images, perhaps the potential for sport as a liberatory activity would be closer to a reality. And this increase in the hyper-heterosexuality of women, hyper-heterosexualization of women, which is a backlash, I believe, and acknowledges the potential for women's sports as a liberatory activity, would only occur in fleeting moments in the history of sport. Women's sports is onto something, I think, that is potentially unsettling to the status quo of how we define gender and female sexuality. But like all social change, it's one step forward and two steps back, or two steps forward and one step back. And I see the images that Mary Jo presented us as one of the one steps back. My hope is that we'll keep moving forward and that there will be more opportunities to see the images that we just looked, a sample of the four of the slides that we just showed, of women showing their physical prowess without compromise, without apology, and in all the diversity that's really true of the women's sports world. Thank you.
Our next panelist is Dr. Susan Brownell, who's an associate professor of anthropology at the University of Missouri-St. Louis, though she's currently a visiting associate professor of anthropology at Yale University. Professor Brownell is the author of Training the Body for China, Sports and the Moral Order of the People's Republic, a book based on extensive fieldwork in China, which included her own competition as a collegiate athlete there. I think, was it for Beijing University? Is that right? Close enough. Well, you can correct me. She's also just appointed by the International Olympic Committee to the Research Council of the Olympic Studies Center in Lausanne, Switzerland. That sounds like a pretty hefty gig. Maybe you'll tell us a little more about that. But tonight she's going to talk specifically about her work on gender and nationalism in Chinese sports.
I'd like to start by thanking the Tucker Center and the MacArthur Program for sponsoring such an interesting and timely panel, and I've certainly been impressed to learn about the existence and the activities of the Tucker Center, which I would certainly like to hear more about it as well. Returning to the University of Minnesota has special meaning for me because this is the place where I left behind my career as an athlete. My last competition was the heptathlon in the 1990 Olympic Festival that was held here, which, by the way, was a very well-organized competition. The fans were delightful, and it was a great place to end my athletic career. I was in the midst of writing my dissertation at the time, and I knew it was time to quit because I spent the entire competition mulling over my next theoretical arguments. I'd like to begin by showing three video clips of Chinese sportswomen that were shown on US television in 1995 and 1996. I had nothing to do with the first one. I was interviewed for the second program. I was a talking head, but I won't show that part of the program. And I acted as a consultant on the third program, and the producer of the program claimed to have read my book. And so the third one really sort of reflects a theme that's found in my book, which I'll talk with later on today. So if we can get ready to roll with the first piece. This is from an NBC report about the 1995 Pan-Pacific Swimming Championships.
We were in another U.S. swimmer, and we were talking, having a good time, and putting on our swimsuits, you know, getting ready for a race, and all of a sudden, you know, we have our suits up about around our knees, and we hear these really deep voices. We were freaked out, and we went, and grabbed our towels and put them around us really quick, and we looked, and it was just, you know, two Chinese women.
Amidst thunderous clouds of resentment and rumor of systematic doping, Team China's dominance of women's swimming peaked last September at the World Championships in Rome, incredibly placing first in 12 out of 16 events.
The second clip's from this documentary entitled The Ultimate Athlete,
there's a different
shown on the Discovery Channel.
Psychological and physical welfare of children in China. Great store is set by learning as diligently as possible with less concern for individual well-being.
Stop. Firstly, to become a champion gymnast, an athlete must have a strong will. Strong will and character are very important. Secondly, gymnasts have to be prepared to accept greater hardship than ordinary children, as the training is very tough.
Mind that some of the stresses and schedules to which small children are subject in the gymnastics business, for example, do constitute child abuse. How much suffering is too much? Which sorts of procedures are more than civilized people should tolerate? At what age should children be sucked into the high-performance factory under the tutelage of adult coaches whose one purpose really is to produce that perfect little machine?
Final one is the one that I had some input into, shown during NBC's coverage of the gymnastics during the Atlanta Olympic Games.
Over girls and women routinely do the most backbreaking work. Confucianism's three obediences have long held that a girl shall obey her father, a wife her husband, a widow her son. That hardship makes for an uncommonly coachable athlete and is a legacy written on the wrinkled faces of old women.
Chinese women are better able to endure hardships and eat bitterness than Western women.
Reforms only beginning to take hold, sports can be the quickest way to status and prosperity. So most parents are willing to entrust their child to one of the many sports schools around the country, which take children from age 5 or 6 and match them with sports best suited to their physiques. If one cannot stand the rigors of training, there are plenty more to choose from. In China, after all, when they tell you you're one in a million, there are 1,000 more just like you. The prize pupils of these schools will leave behind the life that is only steps from this modern training center in the Yunnan province. Here, Chen Yen is one of those reaching for glory. Only 15, she's already a gold medal favorite. One of a new crop of female swimmers bound for Atlanta. To them, it is worth spending weeks away from home to atone for China's embarrassment from the steroid scandals.
Face up.
Athletes like Chen and Lu Li Min, a world champion, now lead in spite of tradition that tells women to follow.
Times have changed. Things are different, and our society has progressed. Confucius was a great philosopher, but now, what men can do, women should also be able to do.
Shot putter Wang Jihong is a favorite for the gold. So is Wang Junsha. Despite their suffering, or perhaps because of it, China has no bigger stars than its women. They've even become symbols of emancipation. 2 years ago, Wang left Ma's camp, citing beatings and neglect. And at China's Olympic trials, she proved she could be a star on her own. For more than than a billion people, women, will be carrying China's hopes for glory in Atlanta. Gymnast Mo Hui Lan is a reigning world champion. Defending Olympic champion diver Fu Ming Sha is still only 17 years old. And women of other nations will be striving for the standards set by China's runners and swimmers. Chairman Mao was never fully able to persuade his people that woman holds up half the sky. But at these Olympics, Chinese women will hold up much more than that.
Thanks, that's the end of the video clip. I think it's fair to say that these pieces are very representative of US media coverage of Chinese sports, and that in the year 2000, nothing much has changed. Some of you may have seen the feature during the Sydney Olympic coverage, for example, about the Chinese gymnast who only gets to see her parents once a year. I could have included that, but I didn't have time. So portraits of Chinese sportswomen in US media typically paint one of two pictures. Either they are adult, masculinized drug cheats, or they're abused, prepubescent children. In neither case are they presented as mature feminine women. And I think this contrasts with the tendency towards hyper-feminized images of US sportswomen that was just discussed. I'd like to start then by asking the question, why is US media coverage of Chinese sportswomen different from coverage of American sportswomen? And what does this tell us about a larger world order of gender? I think we need to begin by recalling that Title IX and the growth of girls and women's sports in the US gained their impetus from the Cold War. The Soviet Union and East Germany were winning the total medal counts in the Olympic Games largely due to the superiority of their female athletes. There are other factors, of course, but the development of girls and women's sports in the US cannot be viewed independently of the legacy of the Cold War. And I think in this sense, we might even have to acknowledge that the development of girls' sports in the US owes a certain debt to socialism. It has only been in the last decade that scholars have started to understand that gender and sexuality are intertwined with nationalism around the world. Nations define themselves in opposition to other nations, and they use gender to do that. During the Cold War, much of the American rhetoric and media imagery surrounding the US-Soviet rivalry in Olympic sports boiled down to an attempt to show that Soviet men were monsters and Soviet women were men. And this perverted social order symbolized a perverted political order. American sportswomen were depicted as real women, natural women, in contrast to the unnatural, doped-up, communist non-woman. Sports in the US then was never just about what it meant to be a woman. It was also about what it meant to be an American woman. And this was one of the sources of the pressure on the media to produce hyper-feminized images of US sportswomen. And of course, lesbians and insufficiently feminine US sportswomen threatened this nice dichotomy, and they had to be dealt with accordingly. Old paradigms die hard, especially in sports journalism, which is not exactly at the vanguard of progressive reportage. Since the fall of the Berlin Wall, China has been pushed into the role of the big red machine, formerly occupied by the Soviet Union and East Germany. But let's move beyond these media images for a moment and describe the context in China for these images of Chinese sportswomen. In contrast to the US, the story of sports, gender, and nationalism in China has an unusual twist. In China, female athletes have had greater successes than male, and they have been the heroines in the resurgence of Chinese nationalism since the 1980s. In particular, the victory of the Chinese women's volleyball team in the 1981 World Cup is identified by many Chinese as the moment they rediscovered national pride after the Cultural Revolution, which is commonly dated from 1966 to 76. On the whole, Chinese sportswomen had earlier and more success in international sports than the men. The superiority of Chinese sportswomen has been a constant topic of debate for nearly two decades now. It has been expressed by the Taoist saying, yin sheng yang shuai, which translate as the yin waxes and the yang wanes. And this saying is also linked with an obsession with male weakness, an obsession that has possessed Chinese nationalists since China's first humiliations at the hands of Western and Japanese nations a century ago. Feminist scholars in China and abroad have argued that modern nationalism in China has been characterized by the use of female suffering and self-sacrifice to symbolize male feelings of national impotence. The superiority of Chinese sportswomen is typically attributed to the fact that Chinese women are more obedient than Chinese men, as you saw in the videos, and that sportswomen train harder than sportsmen. This last point is the one that is most often emphasized. Chinese women are better able than men to eat bitterness and endure hard labor, 吃苦耐劳, which is a four-character Chinese saying. People acknowledge that women's social status is lower than men's, particularly peasant women's, and that their hard lives prepare them for sports. In addition, sports offer a path of mobility that may be denied to women in other realms. And this language for talking about the suffering of sportswomen, by the way, comes straight out of Marxism, a language that, needless to say, is completely absent in American popular culture. And so the US media coverage that emphasizes the bitterness of the lives of Chinese sportswomen echoes an image that is common in Chinese media as well. And I'm actually not terribly critical of this image because, of course, first of all, I think it's based somewhat on my own book, and it does echo the way Chinese perceive themselves. Also, I think it would be an excellent development if US sportswomen were depicted as tough survivors of an oppressive sexist society. I'd like to see this same perspective applied to US sportswomen. And that would be a kind of journalistic accuracy, too. But actually, part of what's going on here in this depiction of the long-suffering Chinese girls and women is the unspoken message that American girls and women have it much better by comparison. And I think this is debatable. However, I'd like to give a further caution about uses of this image in China. This much-praised obedience of female athletes has greater political meaning. The female athletes who were so successful in the 80s were utilized by the party to symbolize national unity and progress. But in the media coverage of their successes, they were clearly subordinate to a masculine party state. Official speeches always began by attributing their success to the guidance of the party. And I think the subtext of this message was that sports women obey the guidance of male coaches and party leaders, just as the nation's people ought to obey the guidance of male state leaders. It's no wonder then that now Chinese cultural critics are looking back to the Maoist era and through the 1980s as a period of what they call the emasculation and castration of men, Chinese men. It has been argued that images of strong women were part of the party's strategy to dominate all rival forces, including the forces of sexism and patriarchy. The image of strong women, then, did not so much arise out of the party's struggle to end sexism, but rather out of the party's desire to create dominated men. This political order in China is changing, and with it, we're getting new media images of sportswomen. They aren't yet posing nude, but the recovery of Chinese male potency and the forces of global capitalism and consumerism will probably push them to that point in the near future. In the 2000 Olympics, some change arrived at the glacial pace, which seems typical of gender change. If you'll recall, beginning in the 1960s, due to the suspicion that some of the Soviet sportswomen were not real women at all, the Olympic Games had instituted chromosome testing of female athletes. In over 30 years, no man passing as a woman was ever uncovered, but the lives of a number of women were ruined by the discovery that they possessed anomalous sex chromosomes. The 2000 Games were the first in a long time in which there were no sex tests for women. So, the new world order is here, and along with it, a new world gender order. I don't claim to know where it's going, but I think as an academic, what I want to point out is that at whatever level, politics are always sexual politics. Gender is always about power, and power is always about gender. We need to find better ways of conceptualizing this connection in global, national, and local politics. And clearly, sport offers a great realm for viewing this coexistence in action. Thank you.
Our final panelist for the evening, then, is Professor Lisa Disch, who teaches political theory here in the Department of Political Science, that's here at the University of Minnesota. She's also the director of the Center for Advanced Feminist Studies and the author of Hannah Arendt and the Limits of Philosophy, as well as a soon-to-be-finished manuscript on third-party politics called The Tyranny of the Two-Party System. She's here tonight because she came into connection with Mary Jo Kane, and they have together authored several papers on gender and sport. And she'll talk tonight about what this means for questions of nationalism, gender, and the body. Professor Kane.
That's not what I'm going to talk about at all. Okay, actually, I'm going to make a little trouble. I'm going to make a little gender trouble. And in order to do that, I need some technological help. Whoever is the guru back there with Mary Jo's slides, I would love to see the one of Jenny Thompson again. It was about five from the end of Mary Jo's show. I don't know if you can do it, but if you can, that'd be great. Is it? Oh, good. Okay, take it off, and then I'll be dramatic just like she was. Okay. It is... You! Wait, put her away yet. There we go. Okay, I'll tell you when. Maybe I'm just going to make trouble. Okay. Important as it is to analyze how sport participates in the objectification of women, important as it is to look at sport and sex oppression, how sport feminizes women when it could liberate us from images of femininity, how sport represents women as targets and lures for masculine desire and trivializes their accomplishments, it is crucial that we not forget that sport is not only a site at which to analyze sex oppression, it is also a site at which to analyze the production of differences. And as Susan suggested, it is important to look at sport and gender as a means through which national differences are produced. Insofar as we focus solely on sex oppression and sex difference, we are getting ourselves caught up in a notion of gender that does not travel very well. And that is the notion of gender as the social construction of differences of sex that are somehow, we think, maybe given in nature after all. This is a way of thinking about gender that doesn't travel well because it assumes that there are universal transcultural differences between males and females and between men and women. It also imagines that in every culture, sex and sexuality are the overriding concern that they are here to us, as the covers of the magazines that Mary Jo showed us surely testify to. I want to suggest that gender is a social process of differentiation, of making differences. Gender helps to produce things that we think we are certain of, such as the difference between straight desire and not so straight desire, the difference between the male body and the female body, also the differences between national bodies. Sport and gender is a place where we can see this process of differentiation at work. But we have to know how to look. It would be comforting to see in athletic excellence proof of the irrefutability of male superiority. And lots of sports writers see that when they look at athletics. Feminist sports sociologists have busted that myth, but I think they need to go farther to bust the myth of the gender order as an order that is about sex difference and sex oppression. We may talk about the social construction of gender, some sports writers would like to tell us. But underneath it all, we are male and female. I want to suggest that it's difficult to fall into this comforting belief, the belief in natural sex difference, in the face of the woman athlete. Or perhaps I should say, faced with the body of the woman athlete. And now I want Jenny Thompson. She troubles gender. Yes, I am aware that she's standing there covering her breasts. But if you look from her waist down, you would have absolutely no way of knowing whether she is male or female, I think. And even if you could know that, in fact, she's female, you might actually find those muscular, pretty intimidating legs attractive in the best possible and perhaps even liberating way. So, now we're done with her. My point is that the image of Jenny Thompson troubles our categories. She is androgynous to a degree. Her portrayal is sexualized, but it's also kind of intimidating. That is why we dress her up as if she were going to a prom. I want to close by underscoring Susan's point that Olympic sport participates in the production of national difference by way of gender. Our women are hyper-heterosexual and also individuals. The image of the Chinese women, the first image that Susan showed us, was shot from behind of swimmers dressed the same way, in such a way to highlight the way in which those women are identical. Their women, are masculinized machines, indistinguishable from each other. In this case, the L word is, after all, liberal.
I'm going to show a few more slides and make some concluding remarks. But before I do that, I just have a couple of business things to take care of and announcements. The first of which is, after I make some remarks, we'll have about 20 minutes or so of what I hope will be a lively discussion with the audience and the panel members. And then after that, as you leave, there will be a reception outside with food and drink. So please help yourself, although actually, given the size of the crowd, just don't help yourself too much. And then I want to also thank the Tucker Center staff, because although things have gone very smoothly tonight, lots of people worked very hard behind the scenes to make this happen. So I want to acknowledge Nicole Black, Kim Pierce, Tara McShane, and as always, Jonathan Sweet. So could we have a warm applause for the Tucker team? Now, for those of you who are followers of the Tucker Center and who have come to a number of our lectures, we try to always end on a more sort of upbeat note, especially asking the question, where do we go from here? And I'm a little nervous about where we go from here, because my slides were all set up. And are we back to where it's okay? I won't end up with the who knows, okay. Well, where do we go from here? I would like to suggest as a first step the following. All that I am asking of the media and of those who promote women's sports is to rely on a basic and straightforward formula, and that is to present the reality of women's sport participation. I am not asking the media to further my own social agenda, nor am I asking them to engage in boosterism. I am simply asking them to turn the camera on and let us see what it looks like when women engage in sport and physical activity. From grace and beauty, can we have the lights down? So from grace and beauty to physical strength, speaking of bodies, and power, I want to suggest that until we see sportswomen from all around the globe, and perhaps more importantly, they see themselves in ways that reflect the reality of their sport participation, they will never be acknowledged for what they already are, and that is highly skilled, committed, and dedicated athletes who deserve our respect and our admiration. Thank you very much.
So we have Tucker Center staff folks who have microphones down here, so if people from the audience want to ask questions, go for it. I would tend to agree with you, Peter. I think that, and I got a lot of questions from the press about this, who called me. And, you know, I mean, I agree that what Brandi Chastain did, especially given some of these other representations, seems pretty tame. On the other hand, it doesn't mean the same thing in this culture when women take their shirts off, as opposed to when men take their shirts off. And so, sort of, I guess, in similar thoughts to what you're saying, is that rather than focusing on this unbelievable moment in this country where, for the first time ever, women literally and figuratively took the national stage, rather than talking about how we were blowing notions of gender out of the water, we spent a lot of time talking about women in sports bras and breasts, which took us away from what had just happened. And I think that's exactly why what happened happened. I mean, that's my take. I don't know if other people agree or disagree. Other questions, comments? Barbara, or someone?
Yes, I was wondering if any of the members of the panel had seen the recent movie Girl Boxer? Girl Fight. And have had any take on the...
I haven't seen it. What, have you?
No, but I read several articles about it. But it resonated a lot because the claims in the articles I read were very much along the lines of a kind of a breakthrough. You know, one would have to see the film first, right?
Yeah.
But a kind of a breakthrough in the depiction of women athletes and the relationship between women and male athletes. There was an article in City Guide, for instance, about it.
No, I haven't seen it.
Anybody seen it?
Anybody? I look at Jennifer.
It's a very popular film.
Yeah, I'm looking at Jennifer.
She's seen everything.
There's some people over there.
No.
Barbara or something.
Do you have a response, right?
Yes.
Oh, go.
Yeah, so it shows her as...
I have to say that as I was looking at a lot of the images, I kept thinking about grand opera, because grand opera is often criticized because here are these women, even Turandot, this empress who in the end gives it all up for her man. And so there have been a lot of criticisms of opera, and somehow it's not really very feminist to like opera. Well, one of the responses to that critique is opera gives women a stage and a voice. And you asked Mary Jo about the future. I mean, although I can see all of the analysis that you have done and have no question about it, it nevertheless is the case that women are having more and more of a prominent and successful place in sports in the US and worldwide. And I think we can aid that by not just focusing on the stereotyping of women who are also in sports, but calling forward the images of those bodies and those faces. Watching Kathy Freeman run was an incredible experience. It wasn't a pretty face when she was running. It wasn't a lingerie advertisement that was wearing those shorts. It was a powerful and committed woman. And I think that has to be underlined, as well as all of the more negative characterizations.
I think that that's absolutely true. And I you know, one of the things that I worried about in terms of these images and sort of focusing on them is that I do not want to underestimate or in any way give short shrift to the fact that we see more and more powerful images of women being powerful in sport. We are at an absolutely significant juncture, and I think one of the things that Pat was getting at is that it is, and I would certainly argue this, it is precisely because women are gaining more and more acceptance and power in sport that there is this need to move away from showing her in a prom dress to stripping her clothes off. In terms of, you have to up the ante in terms of the backlash. So I think we're at a really significant juncture here. And so you see these, you know, women, sports, and their bodies are clearly contested terrain at this moment. And it'll be interesting to see where we go.
Hands in the back.
Yeah, we're going to have to. Or just shout it out.
There's a hand up there.
Kim,
there's a hand up here, too. You're
going
to have to go up.
Go ahead.
Hi, yes, I just wanted to make a couple of comments, and I'll finish up with a question for you. And I want to talk about all of your presentation tonight, okay? Dr. Mary Jo Kane, I want to talk to you about your photos you were talking about here. I understand about your talking about the images and stuff like that, but you have to understand all of us here, we have brothers and sisters here, and those of us who have sisters understand that we all have seen pictures of male models in our own sister's bedroom. Don't you all agree about that? And the same thing we all have with what people are seeing with female athletes being here. But the main image has to do with how time has changed. It's not about women. It's about people of color, talking about disability, it's talking about all different kinds of issues. Both kinds of things have changed. Back in the 1970s, people were now aware that there was a women's professional basketball league. And that's what has to do with media knowledge. And now we know about the WNBA. Now you're talking about how they're looking at themselves by looks. Myself, I'm working for Washington, and we never ever told our players for Washington that they had to dress up for media day. But I don't know, I know that there's a couple of Knicks players here too. I don't know how your public relations director handles your own situation. But out in Washington, we never forced our players to dress up. And also with the NBA, the NBA players also do dress up to themselves when they do self-commercial advertisement and everything like that. So it happens both in male sports and female sports. But I think the real main issue with the discussion here tonight, and yes, women's sport had gone way up here, you know. Shawan had talked to you more about self-awareness, especially with the Sydney Games. That was the most ever women female athlete ever happened. In 1896, there wasn't a single one. So really, I just want to show you that, like you were talking about in your own lecture, in your own class, about the box models. And the box models are going to continue to get bigger, and female athletes will eventually pass male athletes. But we're getting there right now with all the media stuff. I understand your concern about how women are being treated, but I think that's something that you guys have to accept, because it also happens to male athletes, and those kind of things will change. 5-10 years down the road, these things won't be an issue anymore.
Well, you know, I just want to say one thing, which is, much as I would like to, I have never seen Michael Jordan standing with just a ball.
You ever see? Nike commercial, Scottie Pippen. How many of you guys see that Nike commercial, Scottie Pippen nude? Or those men underwear? I'm saying those male models or male professional athletes are exactly like that.
It's
with
not
Nike.
The same as having your hands on your breast. It's just not the same. You're not as naked in your underwear.
Okay.
First of all, I want to thank you for such wonderful, thought-provoking presentations. And I watched the Olympics, and I saw the pole vaulter, the gold medalist, apologize for her nudity. And I wonder if you think that's a pivotal moment in this discourse, or is it just repentance center, or is it authentic? Thanks.
Actually, I didn't hear her. I didn't know she was one of the ones who had posed in that calendar. Mary Jo just told me about that she had apologized. And I do think that's significant, because I think so many of the other women, as I tried to say in my presentation, were completely unapologetic and didn't seem to understand the significance of their posing in semi-nude or nude. Stacy did understand it, and I think what she said, as Mary Jo told me, was that she felt the responsibility as a role model, and whereas some of the other women felt like they were being wonderful role models by posing nude and trading on their heterosex appeal, Stacy said that after thinking about it, she was sorry that she had done that, and she didn't think that was an image that she wanted young girls to have of what that you had to sexualize yourself as a woman athlete. So I do think that was important, and I hope that more women athletes, upon reflection, will take themselves more seriously as athletes and reconsider that position.
I want to say one quick thing, too, as a follow-up about that, because I want to be really clear. I want us very much to honor women's bodies as strong and powerful, very much so. It's just not clear. I just don't think you have to take your shirt off to do that. And the other issue is, even if it were the case, as some women athletes have said in defending this position, that this is about them honoring their bodies. I would like to live in a culture where women's naked bodies are honored and respected. Unfortunately, I think what happens is that those images then get taken up as locker room titillation. And that's what concerns me about those kinds of images, is that it is not taken up by the culture as something that is to be honored and respected, but to be, you know, it's titillation. So that's my concern, that's all.
Actually, one of the questions that we have no time to get into, but it's something to think about, is what is the place of the erotic in sport? I think we go to great lengths in all sport never to bring it up, never to talk about the erotic moment of sport. I mean, it's an incredible sensual experience to be an athlete, and the bonds among teammates, male or female, or in mixed teams. And I think that we never get to that point. I think a part of it is what you're talking about in terms of sort of we're sort of locked into thinking about sex in a way that prevents us from really looking at the broader issue of eroticism in sport, and what is the place of that, and How can we address that issue without it becoming a power dynamic in which some people lose and some people win, as we've been talking about tonight?
Hi.
As an anthropologist, sometimes I get tired of talking about images, and I want to talk about real people and the real people that are making those images. And I'd like to sort of relate an experience I have relevant to this issue of posing nude. Has anyone in here seen the film Personal Best?
Yeah.
I was an athletic double on that film for the lead, Patrice Donnelly, who was starring next to Mariel. And I was, the film was filmed in 1980. I was 19 years old, and I was one of the youngest people recruited to work on the film. And I don't know if you recall the famous sauna scene. But there was a lot of discussion about the sauna scene even before it was filmed, and a lot of debate among, there were sort of real athletes that had been recruited to work on the film as well as actresses. And, you know, a lot of debate about, is it appropriate to reveal your body? And if they ask us to be in the sauna scene, are we going to do it? And, you know, it really was a situation of damned if you do, damned if you don't, because the reason that was given was that, you know, you have worked so hard for this body. This body is not about pleasing men. This body is about the muscles that you have. Isn't there something good and proper and moral about showing that body to the world and being proud of it, you know? And yet, you know, even at the same time, I couldn't help feeling I would not feel right, you know, if I were asked to do the sauna scene, and I was prepared to rebel. You know, however, I must say that the coercion that went on the set was really very strong, coming from, you know, the producer, the writer, the head cameraman. The head cameraman's a man named Michael Chapman, whose name I still see frequently in the credits of films, an Australian, who called all women cunts. And I remember in specific one time I was asked to do a stand-in when he was lining up a shot before, you know, the real actresses actually had to come and do their thing. And when he was finished with it, he said, "Cunts, fuck off." That was his common language, you know. That was how he said, "Women, you're through, you know, cunts, fuck off." And I remember just sort of standing there, and I wanted to say something, and I was, you know, looking at my sort of fellow athlete saying, "Are you going to take this?" And, you know, the answer was yes, we took it on a daily basis. So, I mean, in terms of like the real experience, the real pressures that can force you to reveal your body, you know, they're there, and it's not always pleasant, and it really is sometimes real patriarchy in action.
I had a comment just that in watching the Sydney coverage, I noticed that doping has become even more of an issue. And I'm wondering, now looking at particularly the images from the Atlanta, or the second Chinese clip, given that many of the steroids do have a masculinizing effect, is what do you think, and this could be for anyone too, the effect of this sort of increased doping and the response of the Olympic Committee? How is that, does that relate in any way to this idea of difference, sexual difference? And I mean, is it in a way neutralizing some of the difference in or between men and women?
Well, you know, in terms of national difference, I still saw a great deal of bias in the coverage, because when someone from another country, like in the swimming, Inga de Bruin, produced these phenomenal performances, it was always, you know, well, you know, what's she on? And then when the American women produced equally phenomenal performances, you know, like Misty Hyman, when she just ran away from Susie O'Neill, it wasn't even brought up. So American women could produce phenomenal performances without the questions being raised, and nobody else could. So, I mean, it certainly is playing into national differences, as it always has. And I mean, that's just been the norm for reporting on women and drugs in the U.S., I think, you know, for decades. In terms of how this plays into the issue of sex difference, like with the Chinese women, I mentioned the reasons given within China for the superiority of Chinese women versus men on the international scene. Outside of China, people were saying, why have the Chinese women done better than the Chinese men? It's because testosterone and steroids have a greater effect on the performances of women than of men. So the women are benefiting more from the doping, and that's why they're doing better on the international scene. So, I mean, you do hear arguments about along these lines. It seemed like part of your question was whether this doping, which now seems so endemic, might actually sort of even out male versus female performances. In other words, might it level the biological playing field, so to speak?
Yeah, or even in the imaging, though. I think Pat was suggesting that there's somewhat of a backlash effect that to compensate for more masculine or more athletic, let's say more athletic and more strong looking bodies, there's even more kind of emphasis on this kind of heterosexy look. Mm. To, and I'm wondering if that, if you agree with that, or do you see doping as any having playing out a role in that?
Well, I think it was a bit of a shock maybe to the American public to find out how, I mean, if people even still realize, you know, to find out how endemic doping was. So I'm not sure that that has quite played into the media images yet, although it probably plays into the muscularity of some of the female bodies that we see. I mean, that may explain some of the muscularity of some of the bodies, but other than that, I can't say.
Hi, I just wanted to say, I think from what I gather from here, it's you are trying to make women out to be the victim. I mean, we're not victimized. As female athletes, I think we've come a long way because nudity was the norm in the Greek culture. I don't think that there's anything wrong with women portraying themselves as athletes and as women. I think it's good that you can have both sides. You know, you can show your femininity as well as your athleticism. I don't think that we are being victimized or we should be portrayed as poor, defenseless women who this is the only way that you can be portrayed in the media as you have to be naked. Besides, those females chose to take their clothes off or to, you know, pose sexy or with no clothes on. I don't think really that it's a big deal or we should be portrayed as, you know, we're the defenseless female. You know, I think that it's men can do it, so why can't women? And this is why there's a big deal about Title IX. It's equal for men to do it. I don't think that there's a problem with females doing it. Me personally, I think it's sexy. Someone should pay me to take my clothes off. I would do it.
I think that is, again, this juncture of those of us who are deeply troubled by these kinds of portrayals, and I hear numbers of women and men who make exactly those arguments. I would disagree with you in that in this culture, in any culture, it simply does not mean the same thing when women take their clothes off versus when men take their clothes off. And as Lisa Disch pointed out, there are no images of male athletes who are nude. What, where, who? Other than Dennis Rodman.
Who makes a career.
Think about Tiger Woods, and I've said this before in the press, but think about, actually it's a friend of mine gave, it's actually it was her idea, but think about if you care and love men's sports, which I do by the way, and you were fed a constant diet of images of Tiger Woods smiling when he's holding a Nike golf ball with a swoosh over his genitals on the cover. You laugh, but, and I understand why you laugh, but that's you know, when I see those images of Brandi Chastain with those soccer balls over her breasts, tell me how you feel proud about women and sport and their bodies. You know, when I grew up, for women, taking their clothes off meant less credibility, not more credibility. And so that's the thing that I'm very, very concerned about, although I understand your point and I hear it a lot. So if other people want to kind of jump in there, I don't, you know, anybody?
There's one up there.
Microphone right here.
The question has come up a couple times about, you know, the images of women and men and what it means, you know, are there respectful ways to, you know, be proud of your body and say, look at my muscles and I'm proud of my body, and the ancient Greeks and everything. And I don't know quite when this was, but it comes back to me that probably 96, Time or Life, maybe Life, had a series of photographs of Olympic athletes, men and women, black and white photos, that at the time struck me as very respectful and beautiful. It was a series that was supposed to be showing, this is the body that I have gotten from doing the sport that I do. And they were nude, and they were, you know, probably 15 pictures, man, woman, man, woman. And they were beautiful. And they were very, you know, they were showing the swimmer's back like this, or, you know, the shot putter's arm, or, you know, leg or something in the person's face. And from that, I mean, I could see an athlete saying, this is the body that I have worked hard to have. It is strong, it is beautiful, hear me roar, or whatever. But, you know, having your knees together and, you know, looking like, you would never know that she was an athlete. Most of these.
A world-class athlete.
The one lying on the bench in the locker room, or the, you know, by the mirror, or the wearing the red dress, or whatever. Like, all the, how would you know that they're an athlete at all, unless it said their name on it? It's not showing their beautiful body. It's showing their body, well, like a million other women's bodies if you take their clothes off of them. But this, I don't know whether somebody can find that thing from about 4 years ago.
I know what you're
It was really nice. Right.
There was a question in the back, I think. You.
I was going to say that most women, when you go up to them and say, hey, you're going to be in our sports magazine, and there's a whole ad on you, and the first thing she does is, oh, good, can I follow Megan? Whose idea is that? Whose idea is it for the whole thing?
Does anybody?
I mean, I would ask if there are members of the audience who might know the answer to this question, but I think that there is coercion, or I think that, you know, I think the other thing is that women athletes are so desperate for any kind of coverage, of significant coverage, and I've heard women athletes say, you know, some coverage is better than no coverage. I think lots of times, at least in terms of my experience with the media, not that people are asking me to take my clothes off, but my experience with the media has been that they come in with a very specific agenda, and you know you kind of feel like you're a deer in headlights when they tell you what to do. You kind of do it because you want that recognition, you want that moment in the sun. And so I don't know. Are there other people out there who've had these kinds of experiences? I mean, it sounds like what Susan experienced was pretty unpleasant. Is it the editors, you know, I look at, you know, Glenda, this is probably isn't fair to you to do to you, but is it Glenda Holstey with the St. Paul Pioneer Press? I mean, is it, stand up and it's your fault. No, I mean, is it an editor, a photographer? I mean, what happens in the production of these images? I don't know what goes on behind the scenes. What's your take?
the conventional wisdom that the people who read these pages are male, the people who buy advertisers are interested in men readers.
So the assumption is that this is what men want, and
yes.
So we will give them what they want.
I mean, I think that it's hard to talk about, to have this debate, if we're going to frame it in terms of choice versus coercion. And it's interesting that we fall into that, and that our
right.
first defense is, well, these athletes are choosing, because of course they are American women athletes. And when we looked at the images of the Chinese athletes, as you were pointing out, I mean, it's clear that the children who are being abused, as the announcer so helpfully told us, don't have the option to choose. So it's, I mean, the framework in which we're discussing this is helping produce the kind of national images that our athletes are already producing for us. You know, just to be meta-theoretical.
time for two more. Oh, okay, go ahead.
I just also think that an important piece not to lose in this discussion about posing nude and sort of presenting your sexuality is it for a significant number of women in athletics, their sexuality is completely hidden. And that those are the lesbians or bisexual women or any woman who isn't portraying herself as heterosexual. And an important piece for me is that, you know, I think that it's hard to talk about freedom of choice and choosing to display your sexuality when it's when it's a fact that most women or many women in athletics can't even name who they are, much less be pictured with a partner who supports them in their athletics or with a family if they have a woman partner. And I think that that's an important fact to remember here. I mean, given the history of women's sports and the fear of association with lesbian images, I also can't help but think that there is something going on with some of the women who pose about sort of being so thrilled to be able to disassociate with that image, that sort of homophobia that's still there in many women athletes about being associated with something that a lot of people still associate with not being a normal woman. That there's something about the display of themselves is so hyper-heterosexual that's related to that.
You know, and I think the other thing that's important about this, if we follow this to its logical conclusion, to think about this, if you are a female athlete or any female in this culture, and you want to very explicitly identify yourself as heterosexual, you take your clothes off. Now, the logic is because lesbians don't take their clothes off. And when they do, there aren't bodies under there. So, I mean, in terms of doing a meta-analysis, I think it's really important to keep in mind, what does it mean for an individual female to establish her heterosexuality by taking her clothes off for a male gaze? I mean, that is a terribly important part of this analysis that I don't think we should lose. But that sounded like a professor, and those of you in my class better, that'll be on the midterm. Time for a couple more questions. Cindy.
Get exposure, so to speak, for female athletes. It's also, like I think you might have mentioned, a way to make a buck, especially when women's tennis, the U.S. Open, is the only arena where women are paid equally to men. And so these American women pose, and they kill several birds with one stone. The lesbian deal, they make some money, and they might get some exposure for their sport. And it reminds me of those actresses who would, you know, do the porno flicks when they're starting out in their careers. They figure nobody's ever going to see Gear magazine. Nobody I care about is ever going to see Gear magazine, right? I think there's a certain amount of that. And I also had a question as to the Algerian woman who I think was in the Atlanta Games running the 1500 or something like that. Does anybody ever know what ever happened to her? Did Algeria have any females on?
I don't know.
Oh. Pardon me? Did she go back to Algeria when she retired, or where did she go?
Do we have time for one more question, and
well,
then
here, why don't we just take all those hands and let them talk?
Yeah, just go.
And we won't talk.
But we have 5 minutes.
You first, Jennifer Pierce.
Thank you.
I'll respond. I'd like to briefly note that that is not the case in China. I mean, homophobia is simply not an issue in Chinese sports, which I did try to write about in my book. It was sort of almost a shock to me to be in a situation where, you know, you could talk about women shot putters without mumbling under your breath. So, I mean, it really is something that's unique to the United States, and possibly parts of Europe as well.
I understand that I'm kind of in the hot box up here, but I hope that you just take my opinion. I just have a couple of comments to make. As a student, female athlete, first I have to say that I do not promote nor agree with the nude posing of other female athletes, but at the same time, the conclusion that I feel like I've reached from this panel, especially with the first two speakers, is that the only way to counteract this over-sexualized female athlete is to promote and push forward the homosexual female. And I think that by doing so, we've kind of made the wife and the mother and the heterosexual female in general the enemy here, instead of just focusing on the media themselves. And I think that by splitting us as women will cause more harm to our athletic goals than good.
I always wanted to say that I think that Lisa made a really powerful and important point in talking about the way that female athletes are pushing gender by showing the permeability of bodies and gender boundaries. And that I think Pat's point about lesbian visibility is also very important, but I'm concerned that lesbian visibility becomes the visibility of masculine women, which conflates gender and sexuality in a way that so often happens. And so as I think that's one of the biggest problems in a lot of the work on female masculinity, is that it doesn't keep the two categories separate. And I'm just, that was really it.
Good point. That's a really good point. There's a comment back there.
I was wondering what you thought about maybe the fact that historically, in terms of economics, the male was the one that is bringing home the money, and so is therefore going to make a lot of the decisions as far as purchasing, and in particular magazines and newspapers and things like that. And one of the things that drives then media is advertising, and if they're marketing towards males, I think that in order for them to make their dollars, they have to push that market and look for things that will sell their media. And so if you have females that want to take their clothes off, and that's great for the media, and it's great for the advertisers because it sells magazines, but now that we have a economy and we have more women out in the workforce, they are going to be able to make more economic decisions, and they are going to provide a bigger market, then they can make those choices and thereby shape some of the social ideas and values here in the United States as well.
Pat wants to.
I just wanted to respond to the athlete up in the corner. I think that I'm glad you said that, because it gives me an opportunity to respond. I would not want to have people leave thinking that I see this as a battle between heterosexual athletes and gay lesbian athletes or bisexual athletes. I think that the issue of homophobia in women's sports affects everybody, and the issue is, How is that lesbian label used to marginalize all women's sports, or to make or women in athletics feel as if they have to apologize for who they are? And so I think that's number one. I think it's important for heterosexual athletes and everyone who supports women's athletics to understand the purpose of that label. It's a social control mechanism. So that's number one. And I think the number two, the issue is that the reality of women's sports, as Mary Jo was talking about, is that women who engage in athletics present a huge spectrum in both gender, sexual identity, and in any other different way that we could be different. And I think that my objection is that the media represents women athletes in a very specific way, and it's a very narrow way that doesn't represent the reality of the women who are athletes. And as long as some women are silenced, and only a particular image, a very narrow image of women in sports is presented to the world, it limits all of women's sports. It doesn't matter what women's sexuality is.
Well, I think that's a really good question. And one of the things that I tried to say in my closing comments was, just turn the camera on and let us see what it looks like when women athletes are athletes. Grace, beauty, strength, power in unapologetic ways, some of whom are lesbian, some of whom are straight, some of whom are bisexual. It's irrelevant. What matters is to cover them as athletes. And what's most instructive is how the media and those who promote women's sports work very hard to show women athletes as anything but athletes. That's the important point that I hope that we all take away tonight, because women athletes do not benefit when that is what happens, and that's my sort of passion, I guess. Having said that, I don't want to have to be the person who has the last word. On the other hand, you guys have been fabulous. Please, you know, go eat and drink.